guess who's back? Back again. Shady's back. Tell a friend. Guess who's back? Good evening, everybody, and welcome to another edition of the Urban Retcon Squad. It is Mr. ToneDef, and I'm joined tonight by my boy, one half of the Adventures of the Black Nerds, Mr. Baron Jones. What's going on, bruh?
Hey, how's it going? How's it going?
What's going on, man? The leader of the Death Fresh family, Juan, will be joining us shortly, so he too will be here to join tonight's antics and everything we have going on. First of all, people, I do have to apologize. We haven't been airing lately. Yeah, Baron, I can hear you, bro.
Okay, for sure.
Yeah. We have been getting things together, you know. Black Nerds have been making it. Now they can be found on not only iTunes for all their past episodes and, of course, episodes going forward. They've also been a part. They're now officially a part of the iHeartRadio family as well. So definitely make sure you check out all their episodes on iTunes, Spreaker, and iHeartRadio. And, of course, the Death Fresh Show. We did take a break last week. Getting the studio together, getting some technical things together. But definitely we will be back next week, so don't worry about that. But tonight we're going to go ahead and dive into the topic. Now, you people here at Tonedef Radio know usually when a superhero movie comes out, we kind of review that movie within the first week. Well, this time we took a break. We didn't want to rush into it. We didn't want to dive into it because we wanted to let everybody experience the movie and let them get their thoughts and everything in regards to it. So we're definitely going to go ahead and review Deadpool 2, but we're also going to dive into Deadpool because a lot of people don't know who he is, where he came from, and what's his origin. And here at the squad, that's what our job is. So, Baron, you did catch the movie, right?
Yes, sir. Man, so you know what? Dude, Deadpool, okay. First off, I laughed the entire damn movie. And, it had a couple of heartstring moments. But when the... Okay, so we spoiling the hell out of it, right? We gave everybody their first chance.
Yeah, okay. We gave them more than enough time.
Bro, when everybody jumped out the plane, I laughed that entire time. I'm surprised I didn't get kicked out of the theater watching everybody get chopped up. They built up that moment so perfect in all the damn commercials. So to see that go down that way, that was perfect.
That's exactly what I was getting ready to say. For those of you guys who don't know, if you've seen any of the previous trailers for the Deadpool movie, literally everybody that showed up in that trailer minus Domino, and thank white Jesus they didn't kill Domino because I love her to death.
Bro, I'd have been hot.
Just in real life. Yeah, everybody died. Everybody died. Literally, that whole montage of putting together X-Force did not make sense at all, and they killed everybody, even Peter. Even Peter. Fun fact, for those of you guys who've seen the movie, y'all know during the interview process, Peter indicated that he seen the advertisement on LinkedIn. If you actually do go to LinkedIn, Peter does have an actual real-life LinkedIn account. So, yeah, he does have actually a real account. Okay. The Deadpool 2 movie, I honestly, and you can put your two cents in on this, and if you think. I feel like this movie, out of all the superhero movies that have ever came out, is probably the most truest to comic book movie that has been created. Because I know you... You have been reading Deadpool recently, like I have, some of the X-Forces and stuff like that. So, do you feel Do you feel that my statement is true, that this has been one of the most truest to comic book?
100% I agree with you. And I think it's because of the madman, the guy that was born to play Deadpool, Ryan Reynolds. He fought tooth and nail for, 10 years to get Deadpool,
yes.
And that was, of course, up to Deadpool 1, to get it to where it really should be. Not that bullcrap ex-Wolverine one, but he...
We'll talk about that later.
He did his damnedest to get it to this point, and I love the way he breaks the fourth wall. Even Weasel, Al, just the minor characters, hell, even finding out about his girlfriend basically being copycat. They went deep and they hit all the notes. Even when he was fighting with Cable, it ended up all dusty and had the uncanny X-Force outfit on. They even got it down to the little stuff. And it's fucking perfect.
Before you give away everything.
Oh, yeah, my bad. I got gas.
That's cool. It's cool because I know how y'all roll. When y'all roll, y'all roll. All right. So that is correct. One thing I did like about the Deadpool movie, even after I went back and started doing my research to refresh my memory, you are 100% correct. They did their research. They did their homework. I always said this about Deadpool. And why, as many times as you can probably cast tons of people who could be Deadpool, the reason why Ryan Reynolds is the best, because if you read any of the comic books, there was a moment in time when Deadpool first got affected in the comics during the Weapon X training. He actually described to Copycat, a.k.a. Vanessa, what he looks like, and he said that I am a mix of Ryan Reynolds and a grilled cheese sandwich. Okay, so even before movie X-Men Origins was even created, the comic books had already put a nod to Ryan Reynolds is who I should be, and that's who he's based themselves around, which made Ryan Reynolds be the perfect person. But you brung up a lot of good key points about what the movie did, so we're going to actually go through a few of them and talk about not only things that happened in the movie, aka Easter eggs for people, but dive a little bit into the lore about some of the things. First thing we're going to go ahead and do is Vanessa. Now, for those of you guys who've seen the movie, you know Vanessa got killed in the movie. I kind of actually was okay with that, only because, like you said, she eventually becomes Copycat. Now, what a lot of people don't know about Vanessa specifically as a Copycat character, she is not the only person Deadpool married. Deadpool has actually had 13 different women he has been either dating or married to throughout his luxurious career in the comics.
Mm-hmm.
One of them actually being Mistress Death, which I always thought was funny. And the only reason why their relationship ended with Mistress Death was because since he can't get, he always kept regenerating and coming back to life. So she could not stay in a relationship with him because he couldn't stay dead. So it was funny. I always thought that was funny. One big Easter egg, I think that a lot.
Oh, my bad. One relationship that threw me off when I found out was, how do you just steal Dracula's wife or fiance?
Yeah, bruh. That was cold when I found that out. You just go out here and steal, the most famous vampire of all time, broad, just because that's what you feel like doing this week.
I'm there for it. I can do it.
All right. Another thing, let's go ahead. Let's start with the beginning of the movie.
Got it.
Now, we all know that Deadpool is Canadian. Okay. So, in an interview with Ryan Reynolds, getting Celine Dion to do a song for the movie was not in the original script. It was literally, they got down to the final production. They was like, hey, we need an epic ballot or epic something to go ahead and top this show off real fast. And somebody said, well, let's get Celine Dion. Now, they were being funny because they was like, who's the most iconic person from Canada? And when they called her, because they was like, they was just joking, and Ryan said, do it, call her. What's the worst she's going to say? No. She said yes. And it threw Rhino for a loop. He didn't know she was going to say yes. So they was like, dude, we got Celine Dion. We got to do something. Like, no, dude, we can't just have her do this. Like, we have to do something. And that's how you got the whole James Bond risquette moment with Celine Dion and Deadpool in the beginning of the movie. Now, unfortunately for me and Juan, it was perfect. Me and Juan missed the actual beginning of the movie, unfortunately. I had to go back. I had to go back and watch that in order to be able to see that beginning. But it was a definitely epic thing. Juan is in the building. He will join us shortly. He's, you know, getting himself together, so he will join us a little bit later as we dive into the lore a little bit more. Second thing, we can't skip over some of the cameos in this movie. Now, like we said earlier, X-Force and the whole big reveal of, you know, Deadpool putting the team together with Weasel, which a lot of people don't know. Weasel really is Deadpool's best friend in the comics.
Like legit.
Like legitimately his best friend. His name, how he got it off the Deadpool thing, is a legitimate way how he got his name. He legitimately got his name off of a list of a Deadpool for people who were dying or who was going to kill certain people. So that too legit.
Yeah, the old lady.
Go ahead.
I want to say I read when after the Weapon X program and him getting tested and it going south, his regeneration wasn't strong enough for him. It wasn't quick enough. So that's why, and they even made note of that in the movie with how slow he would regenerate certain parts.
Right.
And that's why they threw him into that testing center where he met Ajax and all that other stuff. Like, even from Deadpool 1, that was pretty accurate to the comics with him being thrown away, basically.
Right. Right. Now, and I'm glad you brought that up. The slow regeneration of Deadpool has created some of the most funniest moments in his history. And two of them we did see in the movies. One in the very first Deadpool movie where his baby hand grew slowly. and the second one, of course, is the growing of his lower half of his body, which created two Easter eggs that not everybody caught. Okay. The first one was the shirt that he had on was actually a nod to Goonies. Chunk actually had on the exact same shirt, which is also another nod to Goonies because of the one who played Cable also was in Goonies. Which is why he called Cable One-Eyed Willie. It was not because he had that laser
the treasure.
Eye, it was because legitimately because he was in Goonies. I thought that was
bro. That made me just love that movie that much more.
Yeah. The second one, also in the regeneration scene, was off of Basic Instinct. Now, most of you young people have probably never seen Basic Instinct and wouldn't understand why the scene from Basic Instinct was such a big deal. Matter of fact, in today's society, in today's climate, it would actually be considered quite pervy when you go back and think about it. But
most
there's
flawed
a scene,
scene
in
ever.
Basic Instinct. Yeah. If you go back and actually watch Basic Instincts, there's a scene where Sharon Stone character is being interrogated by a bunch of FBI agents. During the scene, she's definitely having this conversation while having on this really short pencil skirt. And she tends to cross her legs quite oftenly. I don't know if it came up in the conversation or if it was just something someone said. She did. She said it in conversation, not have on any panties in this scene. So during this scene, she would periodically cross her legs to throw off all the male interrogators in this particular scene, which, of course, definitely made many, many young horny teens and married men pause their videotapes quite often to see whether or not it was true. Now, I will not confirm or deny if this information was correct, but I'm just saying, if you want to know for real, go and watch Basic Instinct. Okay? All right. Also, speaking on cameos in regard to the movie, one particular cameo I think threw me for the loop the most because it was not an expected cameo. It was not an announced cameo. I didn't even know if this character was even going to be in the movie because he's never said it, and that would be of the Vanisher. Now, looking at the team of X-Force as a whole, I can see why you would want somebody like the Vanisher on your team. Now, first of all, that would be a very annoying person to me because, let's be honest, you can't see him. He was never there until something happened. But
and they made note of that during the interview.
During the death sequence of X-Force, it was revealed that it was Brad Pitt. Now it took me a minute to be like, dude, why would Brad Pitt do this? Like, I noticed that in Marvel movies, famous people have been sneaking into movies for unnecessary cameos just to say they were there. Like, Matt Damon did it in Ragnarok, you know. Brad Pitt here. Like, I've been seeing a lot of them do it a lot over the course of movies. And I thought that, like, okay, this was cool. It's Brad freaking Pitt. And then they killed him off, like, literally like that. I come to find out the reason why Brad Pitt agreed to do the cameo for Next to Nothing was because initially he was in the running to be Cable.
Welcome to the party.
question for you. And Juan, if you want to chime in, if you can, do you think that you could see Brad Pitt playing Cable now that you've seen the movie?
All right, I'll go first. I'm going to say no. And the reason I'm going to say no is he would be too lighthearted. I can't pick, even in Troy. Let's go back to Troy. He was lighthearted, in my opinion, in Troy. His goonish level still wasn't that tough, rugged, I'm going to kill this kid. I couldn't see him with that same mentality that Josh Brolin brought to the table.
True. Now, this brings a very interesting issue for me. Josh Brolin plays a damn good Thanos, and he plays a damn good Cable. If you had to tell Josh Brolin he had to choose one of the two, which one would you want him to choose?
Oh, shit. Thanos.
Thanos. I don't know.
And it hurts saying
I kind of want to have to say Cable. And the only reason why I want to say that is because technically you can CGI Thanos. You can. You can CGI Thanos and have anybody with a raspy voice and a demeanor play him. Okay? So because of that theory, to get someone who can not only play the part of Cable but look the part of Cable and look like, okay, you might not be the super muscular, war-torn Cable that I've come to know, but your backstory and how we got here, I'm cool with that. I'm cool with that. And that's why I prefer him being Cable over being Thanos. Plus, when you're a villain, your villainy is only as long as the series you're in. Like, after the next Avengers 4 movie, we won't get another Thanos moment. Yeah, there's not going to be another Thanos moment again unless they really want to roll with it to do something. But as for Cable, he's there. And Juan went to say he can't replace Thanos. It has been here for 10 years. It is iconic. And I agree with you, bro. But I'm
that
saying at this moment, if they had to choose, because we all know that the MCU is about to reset itself in a minute anyway, with the new timeline theory that I'm hearing, you can easily make Thanos be somebody different. You know, you could. But Cable.
Bring on young Thanos.
Yeah, you can make a younger Thanos. You can actually introduce Mr.ToneDef. You can do a lot of different things. But, you know, Cable's like, when you get a good one, you got to stick with it. It's like Wolverine. We are having the biggest issue getting the new Wolverine. Because we had a good Wolverine, okay? We had a good Wolverine for a while now. All right. Speaking,
what's the prospects for Wolverine?
I don't even know right now, dog. It's hard because, like, my whole thing is I want to say for Wolverine, because of how iconic his character is, go brand new. Go brand new. Create a new Wolverine. You know what I'm saying? And
got it.
As much as we don't want to reboot the X-Men franchise under the Fox logo, we definitely want to wait. And that'll be another episode that we'll do, guys, of how can the MCU bring the X-Men into the new MCU with Phase 4 and our different theories about that. I think Wolverine should be introduced in a third Deadpool movie.
Ooh.
I say your new Wolverine should be there. Here's the reason why I say that, okay? We got to create – we've been talking Wolverine and Hugh Jackman in this movie series for God knows how long.
Am I correct?
Anytime Deadpool, he's cracking jokes at Hugh. They friends, so it's understandable. But you've been cracking Hugh Jackman jokes. You've been cracking Wolverine jokes. You – spoiler, people. You reset the timeline.
Yep.
So this is a perfectly good time to bring in a new Wolverine. I don't even care if you jump dimensions and bring in a new Wolverine because you don't want to let go of your Hugh Jackman. You know, you can do that. You can introduce a brand new Wolverine it this way.
What was the name of that? Wasn't there a Wolverine clone?
Well, it all depends on how you look at it.
Yeah.
Because if you dive into comic books, you have things like Battle World that gave us Old Man Logan, but yet still kept the original Wolverine as well as lore as well. So with Deadpool breaking the MCU, also another quick history lesson of Deadpool. Deadpool has successfully killed the whole Marvel Universe.
Yes, he did.
Okay. He has successfully done it. For those of you guys who want to know when, where, why, and how, pick up Deadpool Kills Marvel Universe. That is the name of the series. I feel during one of these time jump, one of these warp jump, when Negasonic Teenage Warhead... Oh, yeah, and shout out to being the first openly gay Marvel character on the big screen.
Oh, shit!
Think about it. They've never openly exposed me being gay. Now, taking consideration, Wade has...
Isn't Iceman gay?
Well, see, here's the thing. In the comic book... In the comics, yes. And I'm thinking it's the Iceman from X-Men Gold. So when the younger versions came back, he came out as being gay. But in the Marvel cinema, you know, they made him and Rogue be kind of a thing because there was no Gambit at the time, which I also felt that wasn't cool. So, yeah.
Hell, where's my Gambit movie? No.
Okay. Let's be honest, bro. And I wish Juan could talk so he could chime in on this. Do you really want Shannon Tatum as Gambit?
No. 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 Well, what about
hell,
Okay, so bringing in Wolverine, or bringing in a Wolverine clone like X-23, I think that having, you would have to go the uncanny X-Force route.
Right.
In my opinion. I think you would have to go that route. You would have to be building that team and them going around doing crazy shit. So, for some reason, I can't picture X-23 doing that. I need Wolverine.
You need Wolverine because if you look at the layout of the squad that they have right now, you have Cable, you have Domino, you have Deadpool. If you add Wolverine, who was the Batman-like dude they had in their squad?
With the guns, right?
Yeah, I couldn't think. You already technically have, because that could be your new character you introduce in the next one as well, too. So it doesn't always have to be... I'm just saying, here's my theory. You introduce a new Wolverine or somebody being a new Wolverine in the Deadpool movie. If the fans like it, this is your way of saying, let's bring him into the MCU now. Okay? If the fans don't like it, when the MCU wants to do it, it's like, oh, that's not our Wolverine. That's theirs. You know? You can easily recant that. And let's believe, you know, Deadpool can recant anything.
And I like how they blame it on his psychosis, like just how crazy he is. Like, add retcon it.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
Yeah.
To answer your other question, no, I'm not talking to you. I'm on the phone. Before Tom jumps into the next topic, I think if you bring in Thane, the only way we can replace the Thanos that we have now.
So bring in his son, and then you can get a new Thanos?
Right. Like, that way you can kind of Like, you could, because, I mean, we all know that the movies are going to do stuff for Hollywood, and they're never going to stick right. to what's actually in the comic book. So,
with the exception of Deadpool.
Right. So if you bring in Thane, that's your comic book aspect, because we know Thanos has a son as well as we know he has daughters, Gamora and Nebula. So we know he has a son.
True.
So, and that way you could kind of pass the mantle on, and Thane could be the next big badass of the MCU.
Okay, that I can roll with that.
Thanos can say it into the sunset, and we, you know, Thanos can just be some, like, appearance type shit. Where, you know, that way we don't necessarily need the voice, but you always can CGI the image.
True.
Facts.
CGI the image with, like, a Polaroid picture of them as the son and dad.
Fishing.
This is crazy.
Destroying galaxies kinda
like
together.
How, right. It's like just, dad got his hand around his shoulder while barbecuing a whole planet.
Man.
I'm here for that. I'm here for that. I'm here for that. I'm definitely here for that. All right. Okay. So we are jumping around. We are touching on different characters and different things. One particular character, which we've said a few times, but we really haven't dove into, and that is the character of Domino. One of the big things about the character of Domino that I liked is the fact that her superpower is luck. Domino also, in future comic book alliteration, is one of Wade Wilson's girlfriends as well, too. So, you know, somebody's hitting that. He got lucky. See what I did there? adding on to that, how did you feel that her character was represented in this particular movie?
I love the fact that it wasn't overkill.
Like it okay.
It was
like
just enough.
Go ahead.
It was just enough. They hit the nail on the head. And then they didn't make it like astronomic, like, oh, a comet fall down and save her. No, it just everything, what's the word I'm looking for? I guess realistically worked out for her. Like, oh, it just so happened to be a giant blow up advertisement sign that saved her. Or it just worked out.
But that's the aspect of her powers. It's luck. She's lucky no matter what. And I like no matter what, everything just worked out in her favor. What I didn't know, or I should say I did know, was the fact that Russell, a.k.a. Future Fire Fist, which actually is his legitimate character, his backstory is legitimately true, and he legitimately does become part of X-Force, was part of X-Force. So the ending was basically true to form, minus having a Wolverine.
Oh.
I like how they didn't overcomplicate the movie.
Yeah.
Like,
definitely.
Because if you really dive into the comic book world, because, like, isn't Cable somebody's son from the future? Cyclops?
I'm so
glad, like, they didn't mention that, because it's like, well, if you mention that, then we got to talk about these X-Men. X-Men kind of in limbo right now.
But
not overcomplicated. He's Cable. He's from the future, and he's here to kill people. Cool, I'm with that.
But they did introduce somebody that a lot of people didn't catch, unless you have been deep into your comic book lore. Okay,
not seen it.
No. It was a very huddle. It was a very subtle nod. She is a Summers.
Okay. Yep.
And a lot of people don't know. If you pay close attention, and this is for you comic book geeks to geek out who didn't see the movie, which I don't know how you haven't seen the movie yet, there is a nod to Hope Summers. Okay? For those guys who never read the House of M story or anything dealing with the No More Mutants storyline, definitely check it out. It's probably one of the biggest storylines that I literally asked for when it comes to a movie series to bring the MCU of the X-Men. Like I said, our next episode, we'll talk about that, and I'll give you my theories of how it could work. Hope Summers is literally the first born mutant since the age of No More Mutants. Cable, being the time shifter, time jumper that he is, in order to be able to save mutant kind, he actually took baby Hope and had been jumping times for about 20 years until Hope was actually old enough to grow up. She eventually came back to the regular timeline. She is the offspring of the Phoenix and Scott Summers, which is why she can actually house the Phoenix Force. It's a lot, guys. It's a whole lot. So the fact that he said his daughter and named her Hope towards the end of the movie, actually, to me, I actually geeked out a little bit, because that just proves to me that you can do the House of M storyline, which can still tie Deadpool back to the MCU without him having to be in the MCU. All right.
Do you think it's going to happen? Do you think we're going to get House of M?
I want House of M. I want it so bad. Because, okay, y'all just want me to go ahead and do it now. I'll do it real quick. All right, so the way that the Avengers Infinity War movie ended, with Vision being killed off, and especially with one of the times Vision being killed, was done specifically by Scarlet Witch. With Hawkeye not being in the movie, this actually does put a scene in Scarlet Witch's mind where she can actually not deal with the fact of the death of Vision. If you read the comic, Vision and Scarlet Witch did have a relationship, kind of like the movies, and during a psychosis break, she did end up killing Vision and end up killing Hawkeye. Okay? Now, of course, Hawkeye will not be dead, so we don't have to worry about that. And everything is going to be right. They're going to right the wrongs when it's all said and done. But that still doesn't mean the fact that she had to kill the one she loved cannot play a factor of a psychosis break, which we can now see her abilities. If you factor in the Reality Stone in there as well, too, you can still have that moment when she does the No More Mutants. Because we get a No More Mutants moment, you can eliminate the mutants and you can spend maybe a movie or two with the X-Men, bringing back together the X-Team with whoever made it out. At this point in time, you can take X-Men that you have the rights to and create a new franchise based around the ones you have rights to. That way you can still bring in your Cable, you can bring in your Kitty Pryde, or you can even use your new mutants, your new X-Men that you just created, your new mutants that you just made a TV show for. You can do a lot now.
Jump on the beat, man, I'm about to kill it. Nim made this beat cause he couldn't afford Skrillex. But the bass hits hard, you can feel it. Hold on, I'll be right back. Sorry about that, I was using the restroom. I got a katana, now I'm slicing your head, fool. Pull out the 45 and I'll fill you with lead, fool. I bet you didn't guess the next word was Deadpool. With this rap, I should win the Pulitzer Prize. Got a package here for Cable, a bullet surprise. Poke you in the eye with a pencil, I'm a joke. That's a Dark Knight reference, you'll get it when you're older. This stupid soldier from the future trying to stop me. But Roland doesn't know I know judo and karate. Do your worst, bullets bounce off me. I'm Superman. I can't believe you shot me.
Around here there's nobody better, cause I'm here for maximum effort. Don't confuse it, you still lose it. So take a seat and just cue the music. Round two, you know that you need it. When I'm through, the streets will be bleeding. Don't confuse it, you still lose it. So take a seat and just cue the music.
X-Force, don't that sound epic? We're like the X-Men, minus all the ethics. Wolverine, please answer the phone when I'm calling you. We need you on the team.
Maybe he'll respond to auto-tune.
Love. Can you subject of matter, retirement. Everything you do is so inspiring. Remember when you killed that one guy in Japan, stuck your claws inside of him, now you run a coffee shop in New York. Are you hiring? Well, are you hiring? Come on. Got nothing else to do. These X-Men are so boring. Bunch of vegetables, colossus. That goody-goody, where's his off switch? He's so pure, it's making me sick. I'm getting nauseous. There's also this Teenage Mutant Ninja Nigga Sonic. Nothing like the character in the comic. I'm getting off topic. Deadpool is my movie, you should watch it. Sit back and relax, cause Ben Shooter's about to rock.
Let's go. Around here there's nobody better, cause I'm here for maximum effort. Don't confuse it, you still lose it. So take a seat and just cue the music. Round two, you know that you need it. When I'm through, the streets will be bleeding. Don't confuse it, you still lose it. So take a seat and just cue the music.
This is the part where the beat breaks down. Take out the instruments, move it all around. Quiet on the track so you barely make a sound.
Deadpool.
You know it's gonna be alright. Party all day, then we party all night. This is Fortnite, Fortnite, let's go. Wait a minute, that's the wrong song. Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Around here, there's nobody better. Cause I'm here for maximum effort. Don't confuse it, you still lose it. So take a seat and just cue the music. Round two, you know that you need it. When I'm through, the streets will be bleeding. Don't confuse it, you still lose it. So take a seat and just cue the music.
You can make it all tie together. You can make the fact that the New Mutants. I don't know if it's officially out yet.
Sure.
Oh, the Gifted show was good. Yeah, I watched the Gifted.
Is it good? I haven't caught that. I barely finished Gotham.
If you don't know too much about the X-Men, but you know about mutants, it's a good way to introduce you to mutants. If that makes sense.
Okay. Got you.
It's like, oh, these are mutants. Okay, this is what they do.
Okay.
This is their plight and struggle. Okay, this is why Professor Xavier created the school. It does all that for you. It builds a lore for mutants. And it rights the wrongs that the Inhumans did.
did they cancel that?
Yeah. It got canceled before the show even got to the second episode. They just ran what they had already commissioned because it was smack dead in the middle. This was a movie that they had already paid for that they broke down to a TV show.
Damn.
Like,
They rushed that.
They did. They rushed it, and they made grave mistakes.
I hope they don't. It doesn't ruin Ansem's career because that dude's a dope ass actor, and I could picture him playing other parts.
It won't.
Okay, so aren't the Inhumans
Green Lantern didn't ruin Ryan Reynolds' career.
So
true.
Aren't the Inhumans a part of like the Kree people?
No. Well, yes and no. Okay.
Yes and
so
no.
So what happened was yes and no. What happened was the Kree created a new breed of mutants. Okay, what they basically did was they went and gave everybody this mist, and any people who transformed or their mutants' abilities came out through the mist, you got labeled as an Inhuman. Okay, once they did that, it was supposed to be Marvel's backup plan because they didn't want to touch the mutants. They couldn't use them. They just got done doing the whole decimation, no more mutant storyline. But they still wanted people with unique abilities. So Marvel created the Inhumans. The problem was they didn't invest in them like they should have. If that makes any sense.
Got it.
So, but yeah. I'm just saying. So here's my thing. So you put all this time and effort into casting people for what was eventually supposed to be a movie because when they first started talking about Inhumans, Vin Diesel's name was attached to it. He was supposed to be like Black Bolt or something, like whoever the leader of the Inhumans is, he was supposed to be.
Okay.
When they first started talking about it. Then
family.
And I'm like, so now there's supposed to be like traces of the Kree Empire or whatever they're called in this Captain Marvel movie, which makes me feel like they could have held off on Inhumans as a TV show and really put forth time and effort into it in a movie, seeing that the MCU is shifting in a different direction after this next Avengers movie.
Well, what happened was they wanted mutants and they wanted some form of mutants to roll into Phase 4. The Fox deal was never on the table at the time because, you know, everything is done 10 years in advance. So they said, okay, let's do the Inhumans. We can create people with special powers. Black Bolt is actually a key person in the Illuminati for Marvel. So, yeah, if we can at least get a reason why we have a Black Bolt, then we might be able to do something here. And
so,
that's what they did.
So what you're saying is that it's a possibility that it got turned into a TV show and the movie got scrapped because then Fox put the deal on the table. And now the MCU is possibly looking at gaining the X-Men.
Basically, the TV show is the movie. The TV show is the movie. That was the movie that was supposed to originally be part of the storyline. But yes, what you said is true. Because the deal of the actual mutants on the table, it was like, hey, bro, scratch these Inhumans because there's nothing we're going to do with them. Like, we got a whole new storyline we can write now.
Man, where's Netflix when you need them? Jeez.
See, here's the thing.
I watched it.
It would be dope on Netflix, but if you see the movie, if you see the TV movie that they did, they messed up a lot of the characters. They messed them up. First of all, what's the wife's name of Black Bolt?
Oh, my God.
Okay. So, first of all, the wife.
Medusa.
I think her name's Medusa. Yeah, it's like, I think it's Medusa. So Medusa has this powerful hair that she can control and make it do whatever she wants. It's literally like a third arm, okay? First episode, they cut her hair off. So the whole entire first episode, cut her hair off. Yeah. Cut her hair clean.
Just murder
the character off top. The CGI for the dog was terrible. It was this dog looked horrible. The only best part of the whole thing was the Black Bolt's brother, because he was played by Ramsey Bolton from the Misfits TV show. And I'm a good actor, because if you've ever watched Game of Thrones and you see how much of a cynical dick Ramsey is, perfect thing in the whole movie. Black Bolt could have been played by anybody, okay? But if you're going to pick somebody to play Black Bolt, due to the fact that he can't talk, at least let that person express themselves through his facial features. Talk through your face. Kind of like when someone says something and you don't agree with it, your face tells on you. Get you a character that does that, okay? If you get a character that does that, I don't care, he can't talk. Also, Medusa's supposed to be telepathic to dude. So he talks through her. My question is, why are they separated throughout the whole show? All 8 episodes, at least 6 of them, they're not even together. You only see them together in flashbacks. Then you make the fact that they got married be because they were married. So originally, he was supposed to marry the brother, but because of the fact that the brother didn't pass the mist, and Black Bolt did, they betrothed her to him. That makes like that's unnecessary conflict. Like, the simple fact that your brother is heir to the throne and you not, that's not a good enough storyline. It works for Loki. Why can't it work here?
Ran damn near 5 movies off of that.
I think Loki had a Joker complex, low key.
He's the god of mischief, though.
I just felt like he didn't want nobody to kill Thor unless he absolutely had to. Like,
because
you're going to die eventually, bro, but if you do got to die, I'm going to kill. No one else can. And I feel like that's what Batman and Joker do. I can kill you, but I'm not. I'm going to let you live. But ain't nobody else going to kill you, because when you do die, I'm going to do it.
It's job security, bruh. Think about it. Nobody cares about the Joker if there's nobody to try to stop him. Why make up intricate plans when you don't have a Batman to come shut you down? Okay? That's what it boils down to. There was, if there was no Batman, there was no Joker. And the same thing for Batman. And let's be honest here. He kept throwing Joker in jail because the minute you kill Joker, you have no purpose.
I can see that. But you know what I really think? I think Netflix should capitalize on the superhero movement while it's good. I don't know if the phase will ever, like, really die. But I don't know
the
if
superhero
people
phase?
Will be clamoring. Yeah, like, I don't know if people will be clamoring for it like they are now in, say, 10 years.
See, here's the reason why I'd say yes.
I feel like superheroes is like what wrestling used to be. Like, how wrestling was really hot and everybody wanted wrestling. And then it got to a point where it was like, okay, wrestling's still cool, but we could probably do without it on our network. Like, we don't really need it, but it's still going to do numbers. I feel like superheroes are going to get to that point where, like, it's still going to do numbers, but we don't know if, like, we have to have it.
Well, the difference is with wrestling, they went commercial. It turned into let's make money. Comic books is different because there's so many stories from the past that are acclaimed as some of the greatest writing ever that you can turn into a movie. There's so many characters that you can turn into. There's a lot of – who said Neil Diamond? There's a lot of –
No, Neil Gaiman. My bad, Gaiman.
Yeah, that you can springboard forward. Brian Michael Bendis writes some of the best damn – in history, to the point that DC said, hey, bruh, fuck Marvel. Come work for us, dude. We'll give you whatever you want. And he left.
Man.
So, and then diversity is a big thing in comic books that wrestling is definitely missing. Like,
yes,
there are black everything, and it's normal. Like, wrestling is like, to get a black champion, you damn near have to shuck and jive your life away.
Yes, sir. To the max.
So that's why wrestling eventually dies out. Oh, and wrestling is force-fed. Comic books, you pick and choose what character you want to get behind. Power Girl fan, don't ask me why. It's not perversion. I just like the fact that you're a hero without a home. That's always been my favorite thing about her. And then when they threw her in with Harley Quinn for that brief moment in time when she got amnesia, and Harley was like, hey, I want a super friend. Batman has one. that was her whole thing.
Do you really think we're going to get this, what are they working on? I think it's like the Sirens of Gotham or some shit like that, where it's supposed to be like a female.
Gotham Sirens? Yeah.
Like
I think we'll get that because... Yeah, they'll get that because with the success of Wonder Woman, because let's be honest, that is the most successful DC movie, period. Men and women liked it, okay? Men and women.
It was dope.
It proved
to you,
right. It proved to you that we are in dire need of more female lead characters, okay? We're tired of Superman. We are like our 10th alliteration of Batman movie, okay?
We needed that Wonder Woman movie because I don't even know if Catwoman was a part of DC, but it was such a blackout.
She was.
Oh, it was terrible. Like, that might be how
it was.
You laugh, but you know I'm right. Catwoman was garbage.
It was trash.
It was trash.
It made Beth look like it needed an Oscar.
It was trash because of the storyline. There's no reason for a standalone Catwoman movie. There was never a reason for it. They just piggybacked off the back that here's Batman. Ooh, this is somebody from the Batman world. You guys like Batman? You'll like her. No.
Yeah, they like.
We like
Catwoman
women.
Catwoman wasn't ever in a Batman movie. And if it was, it wasn't Halle Berry.
She was. She was Michelle Pfeiffer in the second Batman movie.
So why didn't Michelle Pfeiffer get the standalone Catwoman movie? That would have made more sense.
Because she wasn't a good
Catwoman.
She was
a little overkill. Yeah, I was going to say, she was overkill in that. Like, it was too extreme. But that whole movie, even the bad guys were super eccentric, even beyond the TV show Gotham. Like, more eccentric than them.
And that's the thing. That was during the time when Batman was very campy, where he wasn't meant to be a serious Frank Miller Dark Knight that we here now have come to want. Like, Batman didn't talk with a deep voice. Adam West was out here getting bras left and right, seducing chicks with his bat gear.
Batman was a gigolo in the 60s, bro.
Adam West was a man whore.
he was everything that Batman is not now.
But there's a legit, to me, there's a legitimate reason why Adam West needed to be a man whore. When Batman hit the scene and he first started taking wards in, it was always that, like,
So if we was to go between 89 and now, who's the best Batman? We won't put Adam
on
West
screen
in this category. On
movie.
Screen.
To
movie
me, Adam
West. Movie so, Batman. Think, I'm still going Adam
like
West.
We got Michael Keaton, George Clooney, English Christian Bale.
Nipple Batman's out.
Nah, bro. Nipple Batman's in, dog. Nipple Batman is in, dog.
That man's still apologizing about that shit.
It's not his fault. Look, dude. We would not care about Nipple Batman.
That's kind of terrible.
We would not care about Nipple Batman if Nicolas Cage Superman actually came out. That's the only reason why we care about
Do you know how terrible Nicolas Cage would have been as Superman?
Here's the thing. It may have got away with it because Kevin Smith was the original writer for the script at first. Okay? He was the original writer. Hollywood ripped it apart. Because they basically wanted to do a lot of marketing and a lot of stuff, and they said you couldn't do this, and he can't be here. And Kevin Smith had a hard time writing this Superman script to meet their demands, and he wrote it. He did it. He made it happen. It was actually good. It was actually still good. But they put Tim Burton as the director.
Ain't that the guy that directed, like, Beetlejuice?
Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah,
and that's the problem.